Have you ever wondered about the existence of the universe? How this entire world was formed? And what is real and what is unreal? If you have ever wondered that, there is a perfect explanation for those questions with the help of an ancient Indian philosophy known as Samkhya Yoga. Now, don't think it has something to do with yoga, as the name is deceptive of its real meaning. Because this theory does not talk about yoga at all, neither does it talk about any sort of rituals or potions in something that you can achieve, but rather it talks about the real metaphysical truth upon which the whole universe exists upon. Now, in the Samkhya theory, there are two main things that we have to understand. Number one, in Samkhya, the Supreme is always considered to be the soul. And secondly, the Samkhya Yoga is dualist in nature. Now, in dualist in nature, I mean that Samkhya Yoga thinks that in the universe, there are only two things that are actively present. One is the soul, which is the Supreme, which is constant, unchanging, unmoved, eternal, perpetual, and everlasting. Now, this soul is something that charges the life on every single living being in the entire universe. It is the soul that gives life to each and every living thing, not just human beings. From a tree to an insect to a bacteria, it gives life to each and every living being on the planet. Now, in the second plane, it talks about nature, which is known as Prakriti in Sanskrit. Now, in nature, the Samkhya theory says there are two main elements that constitute the entire nature. First, there are the five basic elements that constitute this universe as a whole. And I have mentioned this in one of my earlier videos as well, where I've dedicated one whole video to that, which is these five basic properties, namely fire, air, sky, earth, and water. These five basic elements constitute the entire universe, regardless of the age that the universe is in, but it might vary upon the different ages in terms of composition. And that is why in some ages, certain characteristics would be a little more prevalent and predominant than some of the other things. Now, this is what I'll cover in one of my other videos, and I will also talk about Samkhya Yoga in detail in one of the future episodes as well. Now, secondly, there is something in the nature that is also known as the five subtle properties along with the five basic elements. Now, these five elements are known as sound, touch, taste, form, and smell. Now, these five elements, as well as the five basic elements of the entire universe, they are unchanging, yes. But the problem is, these elements change over the different yugas of the universe, and they change in its very core composition. And that cannot be controlled. So these elements are unchanging, yet they can be changed as per the rotations and the changes in the solar system as a whole. Whereas in the first plane, when we talk about Purusha, the soul, it is unchanging, it is unmoved, it is constant, it is something that cannot be killed, it is something that cannot be born, as it is the perpetual and metaphysical truth that constitutes the whole universe. And as I said, it is that very soul that ignites the life in every living thing in the universe. And that very soul is present in every living thing, not just a human being. Anything that has a life has a soul. Now, many of us in the modern era, when we are traveling towards a materialistic goals, we are only bothered about the natural plane of the universe. We are mostly ignorant to the other plane, which is the soul. So when we are totally one-dimensional, we don't explore all the opportunities that the universe is offering us. And this is because we are missing something that is called in the Samkhya Yoga as Buddhi Yoga. Buddhi Yoga literally means intellect or just an understanding. By understanding, we are able to discriminate the real difference between Purusha and Prakriti. Now, it is this very Buddha Yoga that enables us to reach our sense organs and act it out in the way we normally do. Whether when we hear something from a distance, we are able to hear it. We are able to smell something. We are able to see something. It is that intellect that enables us to do these things and feel these things. The same way, if we are able to nurture our intellect towards identifying these two distinct elements, we would be able to reach a supreme form of understanding that is differentiating between the soul and nature. Now we have to take our intellect as that of a child. We have to take care of it like a child. And I say this mainly because it is ignorant when it walks into a human body. Now we have to nurture it with the right kind of knowledge, with the right kind of wisdom, with the right kind of exposure. And if we are able to do this, then the intellect slowly develops a bit by bit every day. And finally, it understands the metaphysical truth that already exists in its consciousness. Now, this is not something that you need to go in search of. This is something that you have to realize. In nature, in the second plane, in nature, the Sankhya theory always says, in nature, you always have to go in search of something, whether it is the goals that you want to pursue or whether it is something materialistic that you want to achieve. You have to go in search of everything as nothing is constant in that plane. But in the plane of the soul, everything is constant and all you have to do is realize. And I will give you an example for that. Now imagine this room that we are sitting in is dark. Now in this dark room, all I need to do is just turn a lamp on. If I turn a lamp on, the light completely enlightens the room from end to end. I just have to turn it on. But if it is the other way around, if there is a room filled with light, I cannot just turn darkness on to make the entire room dark. So just by turning on the light, I am able to kill the entire darkness. But you cannot just turn darkness on to kill the light. That is the same thing with intellect. You just have to turn it on. You just have to enable it, and that would give you the immense sort of intelligence and understanding to discriminate between these two distinct elements. Now, one must not confuse Buddha Yoga, which is the intellect, along with Purusha, the soul, because the soul does not have any desires. The soul is nothing but a passive witness to everything that happens in nature. Because it is in nature that we have to discover our intellect in order to discriminate the difference between self and nature. Now you see, Buddha Yoga, the intellect can be viewed as something which is the driver of the chariot that is drawn by our senses. Our senses is something that is present in every living being. Here the thing that Sankhya Yoga says is we have to overcome those senses. And when we overcome those senses, we will be able to understand the real difference between the two planes present in the universe. Now, as I said earlier, Buddha Yoga is something that cannot be reached, but something that has to be realized from within. And it is inbuilt in our consciousness. And when we realize that consciousness, the self and Buddha Yoga unite together and we start working towards a cosmic purpose. And that cosmic purpose is nothing but understanding the difference between these two planes. Now, when we understand the difference between these two planes, we are able to clearly understand that one plane, which is of nature, is always changing. It is not in our hands when we are on that plane. On the other plane, we know for sure that there is not going to be any change and everything that happens over there is perpetual. Now here on this plane, we worry a lot because nothing is sure here. Everything is unsure and changing. There are new changes as per the changes in the solar system. There are new changes as per the changes in the planetary positions. And all these changes cause all the changes in all living beings in this particular universe. Now, our duty is to find the difference between them so that we can go into a plane that is unchanging. And that is the complete aim of the Sankhya philosophy as well. To realize you within what your true purpose actually is. Because deep down, every human being is built with the ability to reach that cosmic purpose, but only there is a little bit of darkness within you which resists you from going for that every day. And that darkness can be overcome. And as the Bhagavad Gita says throughout, it is a step by step process. And the Sankhya Yoga is being related to the Bhagavad Gita in many ways, as in the Sankhya Yoga, it talks only about two ways on how you can achieve this. One is by the path of action, and the other is by the path of knowledge. You gain the knowledge on what really exists in the universe, and then you act it out through your actions and carry out your cosmic purpose over the course of your life. The Bhagavad Gita also says the same thing. The Sankhya Yoga and Bhagavad Gita have the same goal, but they differ in methods over a considerable period of time. But over time, as a human being's life evolves, we see that all of them go towards the same goal and they identify their true cosmic purpose. Now, if you're not able to fully understand the Sankhya Yoga from end to end, I'm planning to do one separate episode fully covering the Sankhya Yoga, which I'm going to do in a few months' time, which you can see as a full biography. And until then, it is goodbye. And as always, thank you for watching.